Let me ask you a question here. How well would it go for you, gentlemen, if you called your wife a warehouse this morning before you went to school, you know, came here to church? Or you called your mother-in-law a building? That's kind of weird. What are you getting weird on us for, Pastor Tony? Well, you know, how many of you said, well, today's Saturday, I'm going to church, right? Normally, that's how we think. I'm going to church. If someone calls you on your cell phone, you say, where are you? Well, I'm in the church. Isn't that reasonable? Don't we all talk that way? But, you know, it's not biblical to talk that way. Because the church isn't a house. It isn't a building. The church, the New Testament has a very particular word for who you and I are. It's the word, it's a Greek word, I'm sorry. I'm not gonna bore you much with Greek. But it's a word, you wanna know what the word is? Some of you know what the word is? It's ecclesia. In Espanol, you say church in iglesia. Is that right? You hear the similarities? You know, it's some of these romantic languages, ecclesia. The ecclesia is the thing that God has fallen head over heels with in love with. That's the ecclesia. Not this here pulpit, not these pews, not this carpet, not this building. That's not the ecclesia. The New Testament has a different word for that. It's called oikos. Sounds like something that should be on a farm. But that's the word translated house. From oikos to oikos, house to house. Now, Pastor Tony, are you going to try to convince us that we got to go door to door? Don't anybody leave here today with that misunderstanding. But today, I'm going to begin to unpack for you what my vision that God, I think, sent me here for. My vision that I'm calling it my vision because, Lord, it's really His vision. His vision for His people, but I'm making it my own. And I'm going to find out whether or not you will do the same. But I believe to the degree that we align ourselves with God's vision for how His church should operate, I think we're all going to be very happy for it. We're all going to be very happy for it. Do you like to be happy? Do you like to be lonely and isolated and unsupported and invalidated? Who would like to be any of those things? Let's see. Let's get them some counseling right away. In our scripture verse, and you have your Bible with you today? And if you don't have your Bible, you have, I see, these lovely electronic devices, right? And that's pretty cool the way you can find a Bible verse like this. You don't even have to know your Bible. You could just find any verse you want real quick, faster than the preacher can even turn to it with these electronic devices. It's a great thing. But I'm going to invite you to turn. We're going to be digging in the Word of God today. Is that good? All right. We're going to be digging in the Word of God, and I'm going to ask you to turn to Acts chapter 2. That's our scripture reading. The book of Acts, what the book of Acts is to the New Testament, the book of Genesis is to the Old Testament. Genesis means beginnings. When we want to understand the beginnings of the universe, the beginnings of the sin, the beginning of the fall of man, the beginning of the nation of Israel, we go to the book of Genesis. It's a book of beginnings. The book of Acts is the beginnings of the New Testament after the gracious, wonderful, extraordinary, fabulous event known as the resurrection that the Christian world is getting ready to celebrate in the month of April, coming up, right? It's called Easter Sunday. And Sunday, the Resurrection Sunday, some people wonder, well, Easter, why do you got to call it Easter Sunday? Listen, we call it Christmas, don't we? let's not get hung up on that. The message, the meat of it, is that Jesus Christ, we serve a living Savior who's alive. And this time of the year, when spring teaches us that everything bespeaks of resurrection and of life, because it comes from the life giver. The buds don't come on the trees because of an accident, because of some crazy, you know, Big Bang theory that occurred. There's mechanisms at work all around us and every living thing telling us that there is renewal on the way. The scriptures tell us that the earth itself is groaning, longing, in labor pains, wanting to be delivered, waiting for the sons and daughters of God, their redemption. There would be no Christmas without Easter. There would be no Thanksgiving without Easter. So these Christians, these Jewish people, you know, they were all Jewish, practically, here in the book of Acts. They were touched by that. This day of Pentecost stuff, with the Holy Spirit coming down, was a result of Peter's preaching that this Jesus of Nazareth that you crucified, God raised him from the dead. And now we are witnesses of these things. Well, you know the story. The people were touched to the heart. They were pricked to the heart. And they said, "Men, brethren, what do we do?" Repent and believe the good news was the message. And so the book of Acts tells us the beginning, the origin of the Christian church, and how the Christian church made such an amazing impact on the Gentile world, the Greco-Roman world, with all of its gods and goddesses and deities and various cults and sects. And even the Jews themselves, there were up to 20 different Jewish sects. There was no uniform belief system in the book of Acts and in the New Testament times. And so here came these apostles. And all people could know is that something was happening to them. And maybe they couldn't even completely verbalize it, but they knew what was happening to them was good, and they wanted more of it. And so it says, verse 42, that they continually devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to what? Fellowship. This is Acts chapter 2, verse 42. To the breaking of bread and to prayer. Now, the breaking of bread could be a euphemism or a symbolic of the fact that they were fellowshipping and eating food, which is a good thing, right? But what do we use that image for, breaking of bread? This is the study of the Word. So they were praying. They were studying the Word. They sought each other out for prayer and for fellowship because they had something in common. They were being touched by this man, Jesus of Nazareth, who they didn't even fully understand yet, but they knew that he was alive and well, and he did many wonderful works and miracles while he was there. And now the disciples reporting that he was alive. And you know, he did appear to over 500 people at once. So the resurrection is not just a wishful thinking belief. The resurrection has been touching and turning lives around for the past 2,000 years. I would suggest to you that if you have any spiritual life in you today in this room, it's resurrection power, not Con Edison. Con Edison may be given the power for the lights, but the power for the lights to be on in your soul, that's resurrection power. That's because the God we are worshiping is alive and well and coming again. He is coming again. And so what are we, his waiting people, to do in these last days of Earth's history? What I have to tell you here today has tremendous implications, because Seventh-day Adventists love studying Bible prophecy, don't they? And just a short perusal of Bible prophecy tells you that one day there may be an economic collapse in this country. There may be martial law. We know from 9/11 that at a moment's notice, you can go to sleep at night and wake up to a radically new day on a very pretty big scale. Many of us, and not to scare us and not to disturb us or upset us, but you know, none of us knows what's going to happen from one day to the next on a personal level. And so that's why the Bible encourages us to be prepared. It says today. That's the day, by the way, of the New Testament. The real day is today. If you hear his voice, harden not your heart. But, you know, if you hear his voice talking to you today, then respond. Don't harden your heart. Don't brush it off. Don't say, Pastor, he's a good speaker. Maybe he just kind of like motivated me, but I don't have time for that. No. I wish I was invisible. I wish I was the invisible man. I'd take the things off and I'd be completely invisible like this pulpit and you just hear my voice. That wouldn't be no fun. Anyway, look at this passage here. It says they were continually with one mind, verse 45, in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. They were taking their meals together with what? There's gladness going on here. This was like a party, guys. Matter of fact, do you know that they were accused, the apostles were accused of being drunk when the Holy Spirit came upon them? Don't you find that strange? I'm wondering if it takes some of us to get drunk sometimes to wake us up a bit. I don't know. Some people are just so serious all the time. It's okay to have laughter. It's okay to have joy. The Bible says the joy of the Lord is your strength. And so that's hard because sometimes, and I recognize that there are people here in this room that are grieving for different reasons. A loss of a loved one, or a loss of a job, a loss of finances, a loss in some relationship, right? There are things that are on our mind. We're under stress, and stress is a slow killer. And we need support. We come to church, and we're looking for that gladness. We're looking for that encouragement. We're looking for that something that could be said, that song that could be sung, that would lift our spirits, do something to bring healing into our lives. Am I right? Sometimes we find it. Sometimes we don't. And that causes me, a pastor, to question and wonder, are we doing church the way God intended us to do church? Interesting. It says that, verse 47, they were praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is a beautiful thing. The church is like a godly dragnet that God throws out into the world and catches all kinds, right? And brings them in. They come here. If you don't make three or four friends within the first couple of times that you come to the church, you probably won't be coming back. I'm looking at these empty spaces and the empty pews, and I'm wondering if those were places where people filled one time that never really made friends, and so they decided to maybe go somewhere else or decided to go nowhere. Maybe God pricked their hearts and they came to the place in their experience where they said, what do I have to do to be saved? But then because the word never took root and there was no one there to fertilize and water it, what happened to the word? Well, the birds came and they eat, or the thorns, they come and they choke it, and it doesn't become fruitful. And so, in keeping with this mission statement to build loving relationships through growth in Christ, fellowship, and the church, I'm unpacking for you this week and next week a plan whereby we can bring Jackson Heights Church in alignment with what we're going to see here in the New Testament today. Would you be interested to know more? Okay, then let's go for it. Let me ask you to turn to Colossians chapter 4, verse 15 for a second. All right, we're going to move around a little bit because I'm going to give you a survey to this week's sermon. Rather than staying with one passage of scripture or story like we did last week, we're going to move around a little bit and do a survey and see that there is a theme and a pattern here of the early church that we can emulate, that we can follow in their footsteps. And we could also, if we, the more that we align ourselves in their footsteps, in the pattern, in the beginning, in the genesis of the church that the Holy Spirit revealed, guess what? We can have maybe similar results. Well, in Colossians and in chapter 4 and verse 15, there's just one little passage here. Paul, in closing this book, makes a very interesting statement. He says, "Greet the brethren who are in Laodicea and also Nympha, and the church that is in her," what? Wow. The church that is in her house. Now here, those two words are found side by side. Ekklesia, translated church, and oikos, translated house. You see, the church is not a building. You are the church. I am the church. The ecclesia literally means those who are called out. Called out of, and Peter fleshes that out where he says, we are called out of darkness into his marvelous light. And that is the experience that binds us all together. I have an experience with my church family that I cannot have with anybody else in the world. I and my wife, we come and we look forward to connecting with our brothers and sisters and the faith, because whatever we're going through, when we get here, we feel better. The things on our mind seem to melt away. The problem is that one day a week is not enough. And so people are left to languish, a service, to come to a service and then to leave. And now I've run the risk of offending a lot of people, but here it goes, right? Why not? We pass this like getting burned at the stake if we're going to lose our jobs, right? Only kidding. I'm just saying is that a lot of times we mimic Roman Catholic and Protestant worship. Yeah, well, you know, and we come to a service where you sit, you pray, you pay, you listen, you leave. How is that supposed to fill your heart with, you know, substance? You see, substance is found in relationships. I often say the real service starts after the service. The ecclesia, really, I love it. And, you know, when people get together and there's little groups everywhere and they're connecting, they're laughing, they're talking, they're crying, they're praying, and there's always some group of people somewhere that, shh, 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 we got to shush them out of the sanctuary. This is irreverent. No, it's not. It's the epitome of worship that's happening. When people are seeking each other out and they're craving fellowship, they want to be known and they want to know. This is the ecclesia that God loves and that has called us into. The question is, how do we do it more intentionally? Because it does kind of happen naturally already. When the service is ended and a lot of you leave this place, I kind of like, you know, wander around the building sometimes. And I'll just come across pockets of people that have brought food. And all of a sudden, four or five people, they turn around and say, Pastor Tony, come, here's a plate, food. And they want to feed me. And I sit down and we're having fellowship. That's wonderful. That happens here. Now, can that happen? What we're going to try to make happen is that and more outside of the four walls of the church. We would like to see outside of the four walls of the church, house-to-house groups every night of the week, where we can look at our website and we'll have a house-to-house page, and on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and even be Saturday night, there's something going on where everyone can join a group that if you can be part of a Bible study group or just a support group, a fellowship group that meets outside of the church in a house. Because it doesn't have to all happen here. We want to bring people here. But you know, if you notice, there were two parts of the worship. There was the worship, the public worship that took place in the temple. But then there was also the house-to-house component. Isn't that true? And both of them are important. This kind of experience where you have a corporate worship, where you have so many dynamic things that can happen, is important. It's good. It feels good to get together with a group. You hear all the voices. You hear the children sing, the choirs sing, the different things that happen has its place. But it's only half the equation. The other half is to be known, to be confirmed, to be used. Turn with me in your Bible to Acts chapter 5. We're going to move right along here now. And look at verse 42 of Acts chapter 5. Because this is just simply a summary, moving forward, of what was going on. Gamaliel was really giving his counsel to the Sanhedrin. They were very upset that Peter and John and the apostles were still preaching about Jesus of Nazareth. And Luke tells us what was going on that was troubling them. It says in verse 42 that how many? How often? Once a week? It says, every day in the temple and from house to house, they kept right on teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. That was their subject matter. Jesus. It was all about Jesus. Jesus is the head of the church. You see? And they made Jesus the center, talking about Jesus. Now, of course, you know, people can't be doing this every day. But what if we just started out doing it once a week, other than Saturday? How would that transform your life if you had a group that you can go to, that you could just sit down and just share your load of living life and how maybe certain things are getting you down? You don't have to always come up and say, Happy Sabbath. Because maybe it's not a happy Sabbath. Maybe you're upset about something. Maybe there's something that's stressing you out. We all have the need to talk to somebody about that because we get relief that way. A load that's borne by two is half a load. But you know, some people don't have that. And certainly this is not the venue for that, because I'm one talking head up here and you're all these talking heads down there that's looking up to me, but you're not looking at each other. I see all the faces here. But if you were in a circle of people of about maybe 7 or 8, 9, 10 people, you might feel like sharing, or maybe not, because you know, for some people, when the group gets two or three, that's too big for them. Yeah. But you know, again, it's still smaller. A church, and this is what happened in the book of Acts. The church in the book of Acts grew larger and smaller at the same time, simultaneously. They grew larger in that more and more people, thousands of people were baptized one day, right? Then more and more people believed. And then they grew smaller in that they didn't go to the synagogues because Jesus Christ wasn't welcome there. they had to go from house to house. And so it says every day they went from house to house. Let's move on a little further now. Let's go to Acts chapter 8, verse 3. You remember the Apostle Paul was angry about that. And so when he got his horns twisted, he decided, let me get letters from the Sanhedrin and the high priest, and let me go and we'll take care of this movement, that way. Okay? They were not known as Christians yet. It was called that way. Christianity was looked upon as a sect of Judaism. It was not fully understood by the Romans. It was not even fully understood by the Jews. They just knew that they didn't like it. And certainly Saul of Tarsus didn't like it. And so here was this ancient terrorist, Saul of Tarsus, going out, and he's hunting down, verse 3. What is he hunting down? He began ravaging the what? The church. Was the church a building? No, because you see, Saul the terrorist knew where to go to find the ecclesia. He went to the oikos, the house. He went from house to house. And what did he do? He dragging off men and women, he would put them in prison. How about that? What happens one day when you wake up and there's a chain on those beautiful doors that were just installed in the church? Again, you see, I have a bad habit too. What did I just do? I just called this building the church. This is the building. Well, Pastor, it's disrespectful. We shouldn't call it just the building. This is the church. No. Sorry. This building is not the church. This building is a building where the church is. Get it straight. And so what would happen if you woke up and there was a chain, you come to church, there we go again, on Saturday morning, see how programmed I am? We come to this building on Saturday morning and there's a chain on the door. There's martial law going on. Why? Well, I don't know. There is some sort of terrorist threat. No public meetings for the next month. What are you going to do now? Well, you guys will probably get on the phone and try to talk to each other and figure out, well, where are we going to meet? And some people would probably meet. Other people will be left out until somehow maybe they find. Well, what are we waiting for? If prophecy tells us that maybe one day anything can happen, and if the New Testament church was healthy, because you see, the reason why this church grew was because it was a healthy church. There were people that got to know each other. You know, there are some people in this church, I imagine, that you've been coming here for 5 years, and there's still plenty of people don't know your name. Yeah, we're all shaking our head. That disturbs me. I understand that because I got quite a challenge ahead of me myself to try to get to know people's names, you know? But if we had 25 house churches or house groups, if we had 25 homes where the church was meeting in that home during the week, and in that group, you had maybe 10 other people that you would get together and you have a little light there and you open up the word of life and you share your heart and then you pray together and then you go home. It doesn't have to be a marathon thing all the time. It's contained. On Wednesday nights, starting in April, myself and Pastor Jamel are going to do a house-to-house training on Wednesday nights. Can I hear an amen? In other words, midweek service is going to be resurrected on Wednesday night in April. And starting on April 1st, don't be a fool and not come. April 1st is 7:30. And I'm going to give you materials. I have a little book called From House to House. We're going to do a training. We're going to have little labs over here where I'm going to simulate, you know, groups here and there and everywhere. We're going to talk about what it means to be a facilitator. In order to start a house group, you have to have a core four people, a facilitator, an assistant, a host, and like a secretary, four people. And those people go about and they bring more people into the group. The group does only gets to be about maybe 12 tops. Why? Why 12? Because that's how many foundations there are in the New Jerusalem. And that's how many disciples there were. And that's how many tribes there were. 12 is good. The master chose 12 men. He couldn't deal with 13. Only 12. So when a group gets to be more than 12, it breaks up and starts another group, just like a cell does. A cell divides, and it basically, in essence, gives birth to a new cell. And wouldn't it be nice if you felt like you were that connected every week to a group of people who understood you? Oh, yeah, well, I'm not sure about that. I don't want people knowing my business, Pastor. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe, you know, some of us are too secretive and we're to ourselves, not realizing that God has called you and he has empowered you with spiritual gifts, and that maybe he's calling you to be a mentor to others. Remember I was talking to you on that first sermon here about spiritual parenting? Every one of us need to be parented or reparented. You know, as iron sharpens iron, so one sharpens the other. That's what one of the Proverbs tells us. And that's how we grow. We grow in Christ, and we grow in our abilities to do the things that God has called us to do, that no one else can do. This is very important. Well, let's see. Is this just a couple of verses in the book of Acts? No. Go to Acts chapter 10. Look, and let's read very quickly about the story of Cornelius, a Pisan. He was a man at Caesarea in chapter 10 of book of Acts, named Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian cohort. A devout man, one who feared God with what? All of his household, and gave many alms. What are alms? Dinero, mula, money. To the Jewish people, and prayed to God continually. Well, God heard this man's prayer, and he sent Simon Peter. Now, Simon Peter was one of the head disciples, right? But Simon Peter had to learn something from Cornelius, a Gentile and a Roman, right? Yeah, so God has to teach you something, and he can't teach it to you in isolation. He always brings people together. When Saul of Tarsus was converted, he sent Ananias. Remember, he was blinded by the light? Ananias took him. And what did he do with him? He brought him to Barnabas and Silas, and he came to the church, you see. And that's where, you know, Saul remained, and he had to learn many things, and he had to unlearn other things. God wants to mentor you. God wants you to take you to the next level. Some of you may be very abrasive in the way that you treat people. And you just shrug it off. But someone needs to lovingly maybe confront you to help you to see the error of your way, so that your character could be nice and polished, and God could use you even in a greater way than he's using you now. Because none of us are perfect. So here you have Cornelius, and notice that Cornelius, verse 24, look what happens when Peter finally gets there. He shares the gospel with them. Verse 24 says, on the following day, he entered Caesarea. Now Cornelius was waiting for them and had called together what? His relatives and close friends. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet and worshiped him. But Peter raised him up, saying, "Stand up, I too am just a man." You see, Cornelius had false beliefs about things, and Peter had to correct him. You don't do that. Did Cornelius get all bent out of shape and say, "Don't tell me what to do"? No, he didn't. He welcomed the feedback. And he and his relatives and his close friends, that was the sphere of his influence. In the business world, it's called network marketing. They got it from the church to make money. We got it from the Lord to build a kingdom where people could live forever. Can I ask you, is there anything else that you need to know about what else you need to do to waste your life on than that? Is that a good thing to waste your life on? Then make some time. Come on April 1st and see. Is that fair enough? And let's see if we cannot build these structures within the Jackson Heights Church that would benefit us immensely, will close the back door of the church, and also serve as a place where as God will lead new people, God will not lead Gentiles into our church, unconverted people, unbelievers into our church, if we're not ready to receive them. If you were a good father or mother, you wouldn't send your child to a place that you knew was not prepared to take care of them. Doesn't matter how much they touted, "Oh, we take care of children here," but you go over there and everybody's sleeping on the job. Would you send your kid there? You know you wouldn't. God won't either. But if God knows that we are serious with aligning ourselves with his program, then the question is to answer, are you prepared to be inconvenienced if somehow when you come in on Saturday for worship and there's no place for you to sit and there's no place to park? That's going to be a new problem. Can you deal with that? Maybe not, Pastor. I like kind of coming in here and sitting wherever I want, when I want it. You know, it's cool. Maybe I need a little space. Well, maybe then we can go to two services. Yeah. Why not? You can have two services on Saturday, and then there'll be more room. And what happens if God wants to bless this Jackson Heights church where it goes to three services? Why not? We get another pastor. We'll have three pastors. Is it okay to think big? Dream big? Can you out-dream and out-think God? I don't know what God wants to do. It all depends on you and I and us together, if we can handle it. Because he can only give us what we can handle. So let's go a little further here and look and see. Look and see to chapter 12 and verse 11 and 12. Notice this. When Peter came to himself, he said, "Now I know for sure that the Lord has sent forth his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all the Jewish people." That's what they were expecting. And when he realized this, notice where he went. This is when Peter was miraculously released. He went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who was also called Mark, where many were gathering together and were praying. You see that? They were not in the synagogue. They were in Mary's house. That's where the church was. They prayed, and there was a miracle for Peter. God chose to do a miracle. When people come together and they pray for each other in a small group, we can let God supernaturally work more in our lives when now it's not happening, folks, as much. Not to say it's not happening, because I don't know. But I know it's not happening as much. Because where there is people that want to get together, and they long to get together, and they connect their prayers united, amazing things can happen where now they may not. That's the implication here. These things were not reported to us just to fulfill our curiosity. It's for a reason. Let's go further to Acts chapter 16. We're just moving right along through the book of Acts. If you take your concordance and you look up the word house, you can do the same study on your own. It's 16, verse 30 to 33. I'm taking you right through the book of Acts. The book of Acts depicts a history of how many years? Anybody know? About 30 years. From the beginning till, well, we're going to come to the last verse. What did I say? 16? Mm-hmm. And after he brought them out, he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Who said that? The Philippian jailer, right? And they said, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your what? Household." And they spoke the word of the Lord to him, together with all who were in his what? House. Do you see that? People will be more inclined to come to a house than they would to a church. People don't have any fidelity or commitment to churches these days, to denominations these days. We live in a postmodern world. Now, for some of you who come from a different country, maybe I'm talking Greek right now, but I think that in Hispanic communities, Filipino communities, Asian communities, you already have a movement towards community. Family means a lot to you. But American people are known to operate on a principle called rugged individualism. You ever hear this before? Okay, it means that I don't need you. I don't need a community. I don't need to belong to any club. I can pull myself up by my own bootstraps. I have the intelligence, the money, the wherewithal, the education. I'll get by fine. I don't need your help, thank you. Just mind your business, and I'll mind mine. Stay to yourself, and I'll keep to myself. We'll just say hello. Keep it pretty superficial. How's that sound? Doesn't that sound cold? It does. That's not the Bible. That's not the culture of the Bible. But I tell you something, many people, Americans that are born here in this country, they are wasting away in loneliness. They are struggling. Their marriages are failing. Their health is failing. They're disconnected from family. Sometimes children are living in different states. You know, you see here that people, first of all, were in these close-knit communities. It was part of the culture already. Right now, if we did a house-to-house movement in the Jackson Heights Church, it would be a very countercultural movement. And it's not going to be easy to do. But if you met, let's say, at a home in Flushing on a Tuesday night from 7:30 to 9, and we're going to talk about how to run these meetings and all the nuts and bolts of them and how to do them successfully, then you can think about maybe close family members or friends or neighbors that you can invite to that meeting. And they might come to that meeting where it would be harder to bring them to the church. Uh-oh, the building. It'd be harder to bring them to this building here for this service, because you know why? We've created our own subculture right here. Oh yeah, even from the way that the pastor dresses, with the tie and the suit and, you know, the music and the order, the worship order, and the decorum and the hymn book, and you know, this is all comfortable to us, but it's not comfortable to your secular friend or your family member who's unchurched. They find it weird. They find it, you know, strange that a man gets up and talks for 40 minutes or so, you know, over here, and everyone sits down and listens. We're in a home group fellowship, a house-to-house group. Everyone is a participant. Everyone is a minister. It's the true priesthood of believers, because everyone gets to use their talent and ability for the blessing of everybody else. You become empowered, you get to grow, you get to participate, you get to contribute. And that's why you come across from that meeting and you're not the same person. It helps you to cope and deal with life. Where now, I gotta dismiss you. And I did all the talking. And there you are sitting, listening so patiently and wondering, could this be true? Is what Pastor Tony is trying to bring out to us, could that be a reality one day? Or is it just going to fizzle out and become mediocre? I don't know. I can't do it myself. You have to buy into it. You have to see that what is being said here is real, that it is part of the Word of God. And so let's go to a couple more verses and we're going to close today. And we're going to go to 18, 5 to 8. Right through the book of Acts. You ever wonder how the Corinthian church got started? You know, you have two books in the New Testament called 1st and 2nd Corinthians, right? Where is Corinthians? Is it in Italy? Is it in Manila? Where is Corinth? Where's Corinth? Right, it's in Greece. Very good. You know your geography, right? And notice here, I said 18, what verses? 5 to 8. But when Silas and Timothy came down from Macedonia, Paul began devoting himself completely to the word. Isn't that great? You see, the gospel has always been a team sport. He began to completely devote himself to the word, solemnly testifying to the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ. But when they resisted and blasphemed, he shook out his garments and said to them, "Your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles." And to the Gentiles he did go. He went to the Corinthians. Man, these guys were bad. These Corinthians, whoo. It was a very immoral place. He left there and went to the house of a man named Titus Justus, a worshiper of God, whose house was next to the synagogue. Think about this for a second. Crispus, the leader of the synagogue, verse 8, believed in the Lord with all of his whom? Do you notice the connection that if someone who was a prominent person that had a home or that, you know, that had some influence or clout or respected citizen, they usually had a family and the family had friends. And if that person believed, what happened to everybody else? They believed too. That's a very nice ripple effect, isn't it? And many of the Corinthians, when they heard, were doing what? They were believing and they were being baptized. And I love verse 9 where it says, "The Lord said to Paul in night by a vision, 'Do not be afraid any longer, but go on speaking and do not be silent,' because he says in verse 10, 'For I am with you, and no man will attack you in order to harm you, for I have many people in this city.'" God has many people in this city. I put every family on Google Maps. Yep, Sister Gloria gave me a nice Excel file. I have the directory, and I uploaded them. I have, you know, on Google Maps, your family is a star in my book. And I stood back, and I got to show you this one day. I got to figure out a way to connect my phone to this video and put it on. That's easy. And you see, there's stars all across Queens. And some families are living within a block of each other. And I'm wondering, do they even know each other? Yeah. You may be living a block or two from somebody who's here in this church that you're worshiping with, and you don't even know it. When we have our trainings in the month of April on Monday, I'll put that up on the screen, and you'll see. And it's perfect. I envision and see it one day. 25, 35, 45 house groups meeting every night of the week across Queens. There's going to be standing room here only. Then you have to go to two services. Then I'm sorry, you're not going to be able to find a place to seat unless you get here on time. That's just new problems to have. All right, we got to bring this. Let's go on. 20, two more verses and we're done. 20, 17 to 21. Chapter 20 and 17. This is Paul's farewell to Ephesus. And what does he say? He's, you know, not mincing words here. You yourselves, verse 18, know from the first day that I set foot in Asia, how I was with you the whole time, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials which came upon me through the plots of the Jews, how I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you publicly and from what? From house to house. Do you see that Pastor Tony's not making this up? You see it? Publicly and from house to house. That's the winning combination. We got publicly going on here today. We can do things publicly. We'll bring groups together. No problem. We're missing the house to house piece. We're missing the development of fellowship which would result in loving relationships, growth in Christ, and outreach. I do not believe in going door to door. I think that that turns a lot of people off. You may encounter that one person, but in this country, when you go door to door, it has a very bad connotation, and it has more of a negative effect than a positive effect. You could talk to me more about that if you like one-on-one. I don't particularly, but you know, listen, everybody has their gift and talent, but you know, I don't think that that's a good thing to do. But we could talk about those nuts and bolts when we're together. Last verse, 28, 30 and 31. That's the last chapter of the book of Acts, and it's the last two verses. This is wonderful, you know why? Because the book of Acts leaves it in suspended animation. Here's Paul. He stayed two full years in his own rented quarters. He was under house arrest. We know what would happen to Paul. He would be decapitated by what emperor? Nero. You know Nero, right? Nero, Emperor Nero, he's a nice guy, and you get to meet him one day if you're in the wrong resurrection. Nero, cut it off this nobleman's head for preaching the gospel. But before that happened, he stayed two full years in his own rented quarters and was welcoming all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus Christ with all openness unhindered. That's how the book of Acts ends, folks. You know why? You and I are called to finish it. We're called to finish it. And so, as you think about this, I want you to think hard and pray about it. Take this to heart. Let's begin a new movement. Let's align ourselves with the Word of God.